Welcome to the Monster Guys podcast, episode 34.5. Michael, we've been doing this now a couple of years. Episode 34.5 is a big number to some, doesn't sound so big to others, but what people don't realize when they hear that episode number is we've actually put out, I think, nearly 75 episode recordings because we have two story podcasts in addition to this podcast that are right now still all a part of the same feed. So we've done a lot of talking about monsters and folklore and mythology over the last couple of years. Of course, with a little bit of a break last summer that we took, but nonetheless, we've put in a lot of work on this podcast.
We really have. It's been a lot of fun, and we've learned a lot of stuff in the midst of research and releasing all of these episodes, and we've gotten to share some of our weirder knowledge with the world, and I think that's, for me, the most fun part.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, we've only just begun, because a lot of that weirder knowledge that you speak of hasn't really even surfaced. We've just been scratching the surface. A lot of our topics, we've just kind of opened the box. Now I think we're about to turn a corner for the rest of this season and into next season, where we start going even deeper and really shining some light on some cool stuff. Along the way, we've also met some fantastic people. Some people who are listeners, fans who have become friends, some guests that we've had on that, you know, you think you might interview them and never talk to them again, and you're in regular conversation with them every day, and you end up helping with some of their projects and they with yours, and it's just been a fun ride, and I'm excited that we're continuing to go. What a lot of people don't realize also is I think the average out there for podcast to stick around is about 7 episodes, if I'm not mistaken, the last time I heard statistics on that. So we're doing pretty good. We beat those odds.
Yeah, we did tenfold.
And we're like I said, we've just gotten started. So we're excited about that. I say all that to say this. About a year ago, we recorded an episode about the Windigo, which to this day, we still get feedback about that it's one of our favorite episodes from listeners, that it's one of their favorite episodes, and it's one of our favorite episodes that we've done. And I think it's a lot because of the subject matter and the depth of it, and just how many different angles you can go with it. And this is not the last conversation we're going to have about the Wendigo. As a matter of fact, tonight we're going to share a little extra, then we're going to revisit that episode from last year and touch base with that again. What's funny about it is that episode was recorded still before we had a whole lot of idea what we were doing with sound equipment. As a matter of fact, I think it was that episode after we recorded it, we realized, oh, what does that button do? You know, or we looked at one of our fancy high-tech machines over here and we were like, what does that button do if you push it? And then,
yeah, if I can tell a bit of an embarrassing story.
Oh, this is so embarrassing. I don't know if you need to tell this. We're smarter than this, Michael.
We are. And I work with computers and teach people how to do stuff with computers all day long.
But we're not sound engineers by any length of the definition.
So we had actually purchased a decent setup. We both have pretty good mics, and we have equipment running from the mics into the computers to record and everything. And it's not...
it's okay. It gets us by.
Yeah, it gets us
it's
by.
It's not a studio, but
it's not,
it
you know,
works.
It's not the basic mic either. But right. I think, as you were saying, it was after the Wendigo, I think, that we realized, although the mics were hooked up and although the drivers had been downloaded for the mic so that the computer could, you know, work with the mics, we hadn't selected the mics within our recording program. So I remember
you're
trying to...
Us,
it was a well-kept secret at that time, but I think it's time to tell this. We go for almost a year of recording at that point, I think, or several months at least.
Yeah, getting with to the new Wendigo mics and all that stuff.
And realize that we haven't actually been using mics. We've been using one computer speaker for the both of us, or right. one computer mic for the both of us.
And so. It was so incredibly infuriating because week after week, I'm sitting here and I'm like, you know what? I've helped produce bands. I've helped record bands in professional studios. I've worked on all kinds of different projects with sound. It can't be that hard. And one of the problems is because, you know, as everybody knows by now, you're pretty soft-spoken, and I work very hard to get your volume up to match mine. And it was just so frustrating because I couldn't get it to work. And then after that episode of the Windigo, we're just like fiddling around and I'm like, all right, let's see what this does. Oh, look, there's a button. What does that button do?
Yeah. Our audio has gotten much better since then. So for those of you who haven't been with us that long and are just now or are recently starting to listen to us, you'll hear a definite difference. I think you touched up the audio on this one, though, too.
Just a bit. But again, it's limited because of the way it was recorded. So
the raw sound file.
So we've come a bit down the road with regards to recording. We're still not in a full-blown studio, which is one of our goals this year, to make that happen so we can really get some rich sound and also work with some effects and some other music and some things that we want to do. But it's funny just how far we've come and where we started. I remember when we started recording over 2 years ago, I didn't even release anything for months because it sounded so bad. And this will tell you how far we come. We started out in a living room and it was connected to the kitchen. Couldn't figure out for the longest time why it sounded so loud behind us. But then there was a ceiling fan overhead and the refrigerator in the background. And, you know, I'm sitting here trying to eliminate all that. And I'm like, no. We got to go a different way. So all that said, we moved into a temporary setup and then we didn't push all the right buttons. And now now we're pressing buttons the right way most of the time and looking forward to a full-blown studio setup and hopefully in the near future be able to bring on a producer or an editor at least.
Somebody that knows all the right
somebody
button,
who knows all the buttons to push. But anyway, last year we had just a fun episode with the Windigo, and what we didn't know at the time was we were being listened to by a couple guys out of Australia from Ballistic Interactive who picked up on that episode. Matter of fact, we ended up interviewing them, I think, back in December or January. I'll post a link to their interview, but they're a game development company producing the game Hellhunter. And that particular episode was inspiration for some of their game development that we found out later. And that was huge to us.
That was huge. And I, as a gamer myself, I am really looking forward to, I just read another interview with them as well. And it was actually super in-depth on their game mechanics and everything.
Oh, wow.
And they're doing great. And I still can't wait to see that come to fruition.
Yeah, I hope that's going to be soon because it really is a beautiful game, some really dynamic elements to it. We were just honored and excited to find out that we had helped to inspire that game and those guys and their development. We've had some fun along the way. Let's talk Windigo because we went into some depth with that from the standpoint of the Windigo as a monster, as a creature, but also from the Windigo condition or what's better known as the Witiko condition or the Witiko psychosis, which is technically an illness that plagues people. It's very deep and very disturbing, still is very much relevant and feared today.
It is. I was reading from somebody earlier today, kind of a refresher from last year, and he had mentioned how there aren't as many issues with the condition as there were back then, but just talking about how it's still a pretty big deal.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting. One of the cases I think you brought up in the original episode was about a guy who had basically murdered his family because he had contracted this problem. But from the other side of things, there are several cases of the same thing happening, but there are also several cases of the opposite side of things happening, where people kind of go nuts over believing that other people are going to turn into a Wendigo.
There is a case that we didn't talk about on the last episode that you've been reading about. Share with us about that case, because I think you dip into that part of this story.
Yeah, back in 1906, which is when a lot of this type of stuff was happening, but back in 1906 in Canada, you have a pair of brothers by the name of Jack Fiddler and Joseph Fiddler. I'm not going to attempt their actual names, their native names, because they're long and I feel like I would not do justice to them. Jack Fiddler was known as being a shaman, and Joseph Fiddler was the chief, I believe, of their tribe. Being the shaman, though, Jack Fiddler was recognized as being one of the leaders of the community as well. During his lifetime, he claimed to have killed 14 Wendigo.
Killed 14 Wendigo.
Yes, which would be pretty impressive if you when you hear our episode later, we'll talk about how the Wendigo are these giant ice-like beings.
So right, but are we talking about killing the creature, or are we talking about killing people affected by the condition?
That's precisely what I'm getting at. He was known for, and to be fair, people would actually come to him and say, I believe I'm about to become a Wendigo. I'm being possessed by a Wendigo, or I'm being possessed by the spirit. I'm afraid of becoming a monster. So they would go to him to make sure that he would take care of them, by which I mean he would kill them,
right,
so that they didn't turn into this creature. The last case that of this happening, Joseph Fiddler's daughter-in-law, his new daughter-in-law, became delusional and aggressive, and people were having to basically hold her back, hold her down. So they went and got Joseph and Jack Fiddler, because they dealt with this sort of thing. Basically, they strangled her to death with cords to make sure that she would not become a monster. And a trader who, you know, traded goods with the tribe, kind of heard of this happening, I guess, and went and got the Royal Guard, or the Northwest Mounted Police, sorry. And they actually came, and it was, I guess, one of the first times that that native tribe had really seen anybody from that authority or from that culture. So there's a big clash of cultures going on here as well, where they come and arrest these two men, these two tribal men, and take them into custody. A very long battle, like legal battle, was fought at that point. And I guess in 1906, Jack Fiddler was released. He walked into some bushes, was never seen again. When they found him later, he had hung himself in the woods. Joseph Fiddler was not released because, being of the tribe, at that time, the Canadian government was trying to basically play tough with this tribe and say, you know, you need to drop your tribal laws and recognize us as your government. So they kept him, I think, until 1908 in January. And eventually they renounced the death penalty that they originally gave him. Joseph Fiddler was recorded as saying this: I desire to ask you not to look upon me as a common murderer. I was the chief of my tribe. We had much sickness, and the sick ones were getting bad spirits, and their friends were afraid of them. So after kind of a long legal battle and a lot of people fighting on both sides, he was actually going to be released. And 3 days before he was actually released, he died of sickness in his jail cell. So it was kind of a very tragic thing all the way around.
Yeah, very tragic story.
From the, I guess, the social stigma or the social panic, if you want to call it that, of what was happening, where people were becoming afraid of becoming these creatures and going to this pair of brothers to be euthanized, basically. And then the ensuing legal battles and cultural issues that happened.
Yeah, and I wonder, with him dying in prison just before his release of sickness, if anybody within the tribe or associated people believed that he had been overcome by Wendigo prior to being released.
I don't know. Very possibly. We talked last year about an elder who still told stories of this, and it was kind of strange for people, or it was unusual or rare for anybody to really talk about the Wendigo these days.
Yeah, it's difficult to get people to speak about these things, and, you know, part of it is preserving tradition and cultural heritage. Part of it is fear of ridicule.
Well, yeah, that was part of his statement was, we don't talk about this because we don't want to spread fear. We want to spread knowledge, and treat people well and treat each other well, but we don't want to spread fear. But his statement was that during, I guess back around this period of time, he believed that some of the tribes were going through a spiritual purging of sorts, and that a lot of people were contracting these spiritual diseases because of things going on at the time where that generation had to go through this set of tragedies. So,
yeah, and we talk a little bit about that in the episode from last year, how that seemed to be a cyclical thing among the tribes, that they believed that there was a cycle of purging that would take place, you know, throughout the generations.
Very tragic topic at times, but still a very interesting one, and one topic that's still relevant to today with cryptids. A lot of people believe today that the Wendigo is not a spirit, but an actual cryptid that you can see if you look in the right places.
Yeah, and some of the descriptions you'll hear in the episode as we discuss it, you know, even give me cause to remember things like the Owlman and, you know, some of the flying humanoids that, you know, like the Mothman that we talked about with Ken Gerhard at the beginning of the month. Though I would not put those in the same boat, some of the descriptions are pretty close, and it makes you wonder sometimes.
Well, even going into role-playing games like Pathfinder and D&D, they are known as being able to fly. The Wendigo actually run so fast that they burn off their feet in some stories, and in D&D and our Pathfinder, they're known for being these spirits that hover around because they have no feet.
And there is so much more to explore with this topic, and we are going to revisit it completely anew in the future. We are having some conversations, though it's taking some time, with some people to kind of gather more in depth than I guess what you would consider maybe insider knowledge about this. The one thing that always strikes me about this topic is that according to what I've been told and what I've read, the Wendigo is perhaps the most feared creature or the most feared spirit among Native American tribes, many of them, if not most, or all. The Wendigo is considered to be the ultimate personification of evil. You could say for many Native Americans, especially those that hold to cultural traditions and the stories and beliefs, the Wendigo is the devil himself. He is the devil who would appear to you in person, or he is the devil himself who would possess other people and cause untold heartache and tragedy among the tribes.
Yeah, I think it has a lot to do with the fact that it's created when you are at your lowest and you're willing to eat another person and become a cannibal. That's something to them that was definitely not okay and something that was pure evil, like you said.
So for many of our listeners who have not heard this episode, haven't listened that far back, please enjoy the Wendigo episode that we revisit from last year. If you have heard it, it's definitely worth listening to again and refreshing on, and especially considering we'll go forward in the future with new conversation about this. Next month, stay tuned because we've got some pretty exciting stuff coming up. And let me just give out another shout out to Chris Cavarato from Werewolves in Siberia, that beautiful song you heard up in the beginning of the episode, which is now the Monster Guy's Dark Synth theme song. He composed that for us and for this podcast, and we're very excited about it. Let me say as well, go check out his site, werewolvesinsiberia.bandcamp.com, I believe it's called. I have a link for it, but he's just released two brand new EPs in the last 2 weeks, and this last Friday, he released a new 5-song EP that actually has our theme song on it. What's cool about it is you can go name your price to get his music at the Bandcamp website. So click that link or go visit him, pick up that music, and let him know what you think. Show him some love. This guy's brilliant. He's a brilliant composer, and I love hearing what he puts out. His music a lot right now is my music to write by. So I'm very thankful that he's producing so much because we do a lot of writing.
Yeah, and I love his stuff, and it's cool because he also, I think that whole album or that whole EP is about, it's inspired by different shows that he likes and different groups of people. I think our friend Richard Martin from The Fear Merchant also has a song in there.
Yeah, I was going to say Richard Martin, The Fear Merchant, has a song for his Bizarre Cast. I think the Ghost Brothers which I think is a show on TV, really popular. My sister actually just texted me the other day and was like, do you watch the Ghost Brothers? It's so freaking awesome. And our show and a couple others, I think he did one for Fangoria again on this one. But anyway, it's just it's a great set of tracks. And definitely if you're into synth or horror synth or John Carpenter-ish inspiration from his films, definitely go check this out. In the meantime, enjoy the episode about the Wendigo. We'll be back in just a few days with a whole new fresh set of episodes next month, and we've got some cool stuff planned there, including some more talk with someone from across the pond in the UK. So pretty excited about that. All in all, thanks for listening. Thanks for hanging out with us, especially during the times when we don't know which buttons to press. And we just continue to try to get better and bring you fresh and exciting and relevant content. We love you all and enjoy our time with you. Thank you so much.
Have a good night.
Tonight, we are talking something really fascinating, and I think much more fascinating than we even anticipated when we started researching this topic.
Yeah, I thought it would be a simple episode to pique some interest, but this turned out to be something that is deep-seated and almost a bit sadistic at times, and more legendary than I realized as well.
And I think still holds quite a bit of relevance to some modern-day storytelling.
Pop culture, I would definitely agree with that. I think even as far back as like the X-Files, this was a big deal. Supernatural has featured this monster, but you'll also see them in The Walking Dead, and you'll see a reference to it in shows like Cannibal. So it's still, a lot of people don't know much about it, but they definitely know it.
And you know what? We haven't even said what it is yet. We're talking about the Windigo, also known as the Witiko or the Witika. It actually goes by there's probably a good dozen or better names that is known to be the Wendigo, depending on which group of people you're talking about or which part of the continent you're talking about.
Yeah, I would also like to throw out, it's got a pretty cool title in English as the Ice Cannibal.
Yeah, the Ice Cannibal. And so that's where the appropriateness of our topic comes in, because this is known as an ice creature. It's known as a cold weather creature.
Yeah, it is cold outside, and I've been cold all day, and I've been very hungry all day.
Yeah, we'll see the correlation there here in just a minute. So the Wendigo, you know, growing up, talking to people along the way, really, at times, you kind of get the impression that the Wendigo is almost like a werewolf or one of those werewolfy spirit type creatures that just kind of roam the plains through the Midwest. And really, that's not accurate, almost not accurate at all.
Yeah, we answered a question not too long ago from one of our listeners about skinwalkers, and the Wendigo kind of suffers the same idea, that it's just the Native American werewolf. I remember growing up, I think it was Ginger Snaps Back or something. It was a werewolf-ish movie set in, I think, the old Wild Wild West during winter. It had some crazy stuff. Like, I remember they put a leech on one of the guys that was infected, and the leech, like, exploded. But these guys turned into wolves, and they called it a Wendigo. Mm. And it was not a Wendigo.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, movies that are out there right now, and even some of the shows, just don't do it justice. And I think even apart from being a creature of legend or of lore, especially among Native American tribes, this topic holds some weight in terms of the collective mental health and spirituality of the peoples who were dealing with this creature for so many years.
I hadn't realized, but we came across several different newspaper clippings and articles that detailed real life people that suffered from, I don't want to say the idea, but that suffered from the fear of the Wendigo and what that did to them and what that did to their families and the victims. And it's much more serious than I realized.
Yeah, it's a significant level of fear that gripped an entire people group for decades, if not hundreds of years. Probably further back than we even know because of documentation.
I was going to say, there's at least a couple hundred years of good documentation, and I wouldn't doubt, with some of the stories that we'll be telling, that it goes back much farther as well.
Yeah, and I think even one of the stories we'll talk about as we talk about listening to the elder of this Native American tribe, how he talks about as late as 1957-58 within his lifetime.
Yeah, just like the Skinwalkers, the story of the Wendigo is still, it's still very much...
It's very powerful and still very relevant.
Very current, still a big part of their lives.
Yeah, going back, speaking about pop culture and movies and stuff, we just watched two Westerns.
Mm-hmm.
We watched...
The Hateful Eight.
The Hateful Eight, also Bone Tomahawk.
Both sharing Kurt Russell.
Yeah, both sharing Kurt Russell, both sharing that Western setting. And
grisly.
Both of them pretty grisly. I don't know, but I got to go Bone Tomahawk on this one.
I do as well. I mean, The Hateful Eight was entertaining.
I think it was entertaining up to a point. I think I told you at one point when something starts happening, he lost me.
I enjoyed it past that. I was a bit disappointed that there wasn't more. Well, I won't ruin it. But it didn't fulfill everything I wanted it to. But I still got my kick. I mean, I expected it to be a Quentin Tarantino movie, and it was a Quentin Tarantino movie for sure.
and Bone Tomahawk, though, I really enjoyed the story and the development, and I bring this up because the evil in Bone Tomahawk resembles a lot of the characteristics of the Wendigo.
It does.
That we're going to talk about tonight. So I thought it was interesting that we watched that movie not even realizing that was going to be a part of it, and that we were going to be talking about the Wendigo this week. But there were a lot of characteristics very similar to Wendigo in that movie with the evil that is in that movie.
I have to say, too, Bone Tomahawk was...
You're over here shaking your head like you're queasy or something.
It was a fantastic movie. Everything from the script writing to the cinematography to the actors did a fantastic job. The four main actors really did a bang up job.
Top shelf all the way.
But there are, I mean, the movie does have its grislier moments. There is one scene in particular that still turns my stomach to think about, and I've never had such a physical... I mean, I was itching. It was burning up watching the scene.
It was intense. and if you don't have the stomach for it, you just need to know when something starts happening, you need to walk out of the room, because not just the visual, but the audible
everything
that's
about
taking
that
place in that scene. It is one of the most visceral and, I don't know, terrifying scenes I've ever seen portrayed, especially in a Western.
I think you and I have plumbed the depths of some of the more cheesy horror movies. We've not had any shortage of grisly movies that we've seen, but I don't know, this one got me, and I tried to turn away, and you're right, the audio,
it just gets you.
I was still squirming in my seat.
It gets you, and it stays with you. It lingers. So we go back to, and again, I bring that up because of the characteristics of the, I don't want to call them creatures, but I don't want to give it away.
Yeah.
But the evil that's in that movie is very characteristic of some aspects of the Wendigo. I even questioned earlier when we were talking about it, could those be Wendigo? But I don't think really in total, but they certainly shared a lot.
I would almost wonder if some inspiration was drawn from it. But
I think you'd have to be.
There are some, I don't want to give it away, but there are definitely some matching traits.
The question is, what is Wendigo? You know, and again, there are so many different variations of that word. That's the anglicized version of what is known as the Witiko or the Witika.
You know, they're... Even among the Native American storytelling, there are so many different variations of this creature. But I'll point out, the common ones real quick. I mean, it's been called everything from a werewolf-like creature to a Sasquatch-like creature to even like a wraith-like spirit being. Some of the characteristics that I would say most people that they recognize are the giant body, you know, being as tall as a pine tree, the white haggard frame that is bordering on starvation and yet is just immensely powerful and has terrible strength. A lot of them have owl-like eyes, which is pretty creepy if you think about it. Mm-hmm. You know, you think about this giant tree-sized creature, long and lanky and starving, looking like a skeleton, these big eye-like owl eyes on top of its head. It's kind of creepy.
Yeah, and what you're describing is the actual creature.
Yes, the monster.
The monster. And I want us to be careful to identify that in our conversation about Witiko, about the Wendigo, there's two faces to this.
Yeah.
And they overlap in many places, but there is the creature, and a lot of people claim to have spotted this creature. It's a North American creature that cold climate, been spotted in Canada, northern states like Minnesota, and people have said that they've actually encountered this beast, describe it as being relatable to Bigfoot.
Yeah.
But there's the creature, but there's also the spirit of Wendigo, or something we'll talk about here pretty soon, the Wendigo condition. They are two very different things, but they do overlap. Stay with us because I don't want you to get too caught up in the monster thinking we're going to leave out the other part, because we'll go into both sides of it.
But yeah, like I said earlier, one of the nicknames was the Ice Cannibal. Some of the other nicknames that we have for are the Ice Cannibal God, or just stuff like the Cannibal God. I think a good introductory story is a story about a guy who, after winter kind of started to melt away, he went outside of his house, leaving his family behind, went to go look for, you know, game to hunt, because it's, you know, it was a long, harsh winter and they needed food. So he goes out with his spear and his knife, and he is traveling through the woods, and he comes across these gigantic, bloody footprints, and he hears this evil whistling, shrieking in the woods, and he knows that the Wendigo is close.
So he actually knows that this is the Wendigo.
He recognizes it right away.
Okay.
You know, the bloody footprints is kind of a giveaway in some of those older stories about the Wendigo.
And the screeching as well. There's an association with a screeching for the Wendigo in a lot of stories.
It said that the scream or the shout of the Wendigo was so powerful it could paralyze people, it could knock them back.
Knock them down. Mm-hmm.
So he knows what's going on right away. And the interesting thing about the story is that he knows he doesn't have much of a chance against this creature. He's only got a slim window of opportunity. And he knows as well that if he dies, he will probably become a Wendigo as well. The really terrifying thing about this story is that he knows if he becomes a Wendigo, he'll go after his wife and children. And that kind of, we'll get to that more later, but that kind of sums up the fear, the real fear, in my opinion, of the Wendigo. But through the white trees, those snow-caked trees, he sees this tall, gaunt figure start to move. It kind of blends in with the forest around him, but it starts to come towards him. And these claws reach out to grab him, and the guy fights it off as best as he can. He throws his spear, misses the first time, and blends in with the snow to get away. And as the Wendigo is stooping down to look for him, he gets another shot, and he actually digs his knife into the Wendigo's eyeball. Kind of gross, but he survived. It's kind of a nice little, you know, happy I won story, but it shows the fear of what would happen if you were to fall prey to this phenomenon, if you will.
And the fear is deep-seated. This is a paralyzing fear for these people that are experiencing the Wendigo. It is in many tribes and many of the Native American cultures where this is prominent.
Honestly,
this is the personification of evil. This is evil ultimate.
With some of the, you know, the true life accounts that are associated with that fear, I can see why. I mean, it's pretty horrific.
Yeah, definitely. So that story, and what's interesting, that the aspects of it, or the characteristics of the creature in that story, stand out. Very tall as pine trees. Some of the other characteristics of the Wendigo as far as the creature are concerned would be,
you know, it's always shown as being the starving creature. For those of you who watch Game of Thrones, the White Walkers
The White Walkers
are based in part off of the Wendigo. And a lot of people think of them as zombies, but they're a bit more than that. They're these savage, strong creatures, but they look like they're wasting away, mm-hmm. and they're frozen, you know, to the core.
Very thin. As a matter of fact, one of the characteristics of the Wendigo creature is a heart of ice.
It can it's got a heart of ice, and it's always hungry, but it can never be full. So this appetite, it's eating away at its inside, it looks like, but it's always wanting more and always searching for food. And in the harsh conditions, it looks like it's frozen stiff.
And in some of these stories, for instance, this one, the guy fights the Wendigo, but in some of these stories, people who are facing off with the Wendigo spirit are actually themselves transforming in size, sometimes even in shape and ability, in order to fight this Wendigo.
Yeah, and I guess I'll just go ahead and get to that story.
Yeah, well, why don't you go ahead and tell that story?
Well, it's got some importance later, but it's actually my favorite story about the Wendigo so far that I've come across. But I like the way it starts out. The kettle over the fire starts to swing back and forth, and so the people know that the Wendigo is coming.
Right.
That's just kind of a spooky, ominous opening to itself, but they start to hear the wind howling, they feel the footsteps in the distance, and the people of the village...
So it's a powerful fear. This is a visceral fear
this
among these people.
This is not just a simple boogeyman, this is...
Right. Like I said, this is the devil. Yeah. I mean, this is it.
Yeah. So they know that the Wendigo is coming, and terrified, the people of the village go to this wise old grandmother on the edge of town, or village, whatever. And
I always like the stories with the wise old grandmas.
Well, here's the strange thing. This time, the grandmother says, you know, there is nothing I can do.
Uh-oh.
But her granddaughter comes up and is like, I know what to do. Get me these items. Mm. And she tells the villagers to bring her two sticks. And then she tells her grandmother to boil some tallow.
Okay.
Or to heat up some tallow. And the tallow is important for later. We'll get to that later on. It didn't make sense to me the first time I heard it. But she's given the sticks. She starts to march towards the Wendigo as it's coming out of the trees. And as she's going along, some of the dogs of the village go and they kill the dogs of the Wendigo, the companions that are with it. But she, as she's marching, starts to grow bigger and bigger and bigger until she's the same size as the Wendigo. Now, keep in mind, again, this thing is as tall as trees.
Mm-hmm.
So as she's growing as well, the sticks in her hand become these batons, basically, that she beats the heck out of it with. And so this epic battle ensues between this little girl and this evil ice cannibal spirit. When all is said and done, she beats the heck out of it. It's dead.
She defeats the Wendigo.
Mm-hmm. She drinks the tallow that her grandmother has heated up, and she shrinks back to her normal size. And a lot of the stories where the Wendigo is defeated, such as this one, the people start to chop up the body of the Wendigo. And here's the interesting thing. You were talking earlier about the heart of ice.
Right.
A lot of the times, if somebody was becoming a Wendigo, they would talk about how they felt this icy cold inside of their heart.
Mm-hmm.
In some of these older legends, when they start to cut up the body, almost like you would cut up a tree, the place where its heart would be, there was this cold, frozen person.
Mm.
And this was the person that, you know, they were before they became the Wendigo. So it's interesting. You have these people who have the ice inside their heart, but then in other stories, they are the icy heart of the Wendigo.
It is very interesting and really plays to the fears what these people were experiencing. The Algonquian tribes called the Wendigo the spirit of lonely places.
Mm-hmm.
And I always found that interesting as we were researching this, and they would blame a lot of unsolved disappearances and other activities that would take place, or mysteries that would happen within their tribes, they would blame it on the Wendigo. Now, here's the question I have going forward is, how does one become the Wendigo?
How does one become the Wendigo?
And again, now, and here's where we start to get into the other side of this story, and it's not just to do with the creature, but what's called the Wendigo condition, or the Witiko condition, or the Wendigo psychosis.
When we were doing our research as well, I've always thought of the two as the same, but one person did make a distinction between the two, and I thought that was interesting.
Between what two? The monster and the condition?
Well, no, the Wendigo psychosis and then the Witiko condition.
Right. I think for our conversation, I'm going to kind of lump it together.
Okay.
So it doesn't get too confusing right now, but I'll be honest with you, I would encourage listeners, I would encourage you to dig into into this a little deeper, even beyond our podcast. And I have a feeling we'll come back to this conversation again later. We've actually been in contact with some tribal leaders in our area where we're going to gain some insight on some stories and legends and lore. So we'll definitely come back to Native American legends and stories and monsters in the future, but I would really encourage you to dig deep into the story of the Wendigo because it is rich and full of information and documentation and stories throughout the centuries that are very much worth looking into, and especially to get past the pop culture identification of this just being another werewolf or another beast of some form.
Definitely. I would second that.
And I think we would be amiss if we did not bring up one of the most famous cases in history about the Wendigo spirit possessing a human being, and that's the case and story of Swift Runner.
When you first told me about the story, I was a bit surprised. I at first thought you were talking about like an old legend or a folktale, but this is an actual...
Yep, this is an actual man and his family, well documented, medically, even religious documentation because of his interaction with Catholic mission during that time, but very well recorded historical case. 1897 was the time period that this took place.
I can't remember the famine. The famine already broken out at that point. Okay, yep. So I remember he was a family man.
Yep.
A very kind person.
Kind person, large man, 6'3", broad-shouldered. Some of the soldiers that knew him, the mounted police in that area that knew him, actually described him as an ugly man after the case of this Wendigo possession, but he was known before that to be a very gentle and kind man.
Like a big teddy bear.
Yeah, big teddy bear.
Which makes the story even more tragic, in my opinion. Yeah. But basically, if I remember correctly, they were isolated enough during the winter that nobody saw them for a time.
Right. And he went, I don't know if they relocated or he was out hunting, but they were out away from the common people, the community.
I don't know. I remember originally hearing that it was a harsh winter, but after that, there were some conflicting sides of the tale, I guess we'll get to. But I remember basically what happened is he came to the Catholic priests and did not look very worse off or wary. I mean, it looked like he was healthy and everything, but he had talked about how his family was dead because of the harsh winter.
Yeah, he actually came and turned himself in. I think he turned himself in the priest first or to the police?
To the priests. Okay. And then the priests, kind of getting this weird vibe, turned it over to the authorities.
That's
the
right.
The authorities took him over to the campsite where they found this horrific sight of bones and bodies, basically.
Yeah, originally he first took them to the gravesite.
Yeah.
Of one of his children and said, yeah, here's where he's buried. But then they found bones scattered throughout. And there's actually photographic evidence that was recovered from the site of his wife and other children, their bones. And I think his mother or mother-in-law was with him at the time.
The reports are pretty graphic, describing different ways that he had murdered them and then eaten them. And I guess one of the family members was even tied up and fed flesh before he killed them as well. I don't know. I guess he just mentally, he snapped. And the thing that was really bothers him was that it talks about how he actually could have gone and hunted game easily now.
Yeah, the documentation, the reports that the journals from some of the doctors and legal authorities that were documenting the case showed that they were not at the point of starvation, and they still had access to and resource to hunt for food, but he, like you said, he snapped. It was just a done deal. He ate his family, and then one report actually said his statement that he gave just before his execution was that he killed his last son in order to remove the final witness from the earth so that there could not be a witness to the crimes that he had committed.
Right.
Which was, that's really where it gets horrific, in my opinion.
Yes. And then one of his other final statements was, you know, I am lower than man, or I am no longer considered to be man, or something along that line.
Yeah, that's...
He knew.
Right as he was being hung, his final words, you know, were something to the effect that I am no longer worthy to be called a man. I am Wendigo.
Yeah. So it's a very real instance. And the surprising thing, you know, I knew about the monster, the legends, the pine tree sized creature with the owl eyes, but I did not know that there were actual cases cases of people who went through this. Beyond that, there are several cases. It's not just one or two people throughout history.
Yeah, Swift Runner, his case is the most famous case that we have on record, but there are a lot of other cases that are well documented. And here's the thing, how does one become a Wendigo? And some of the characteristics that they turn to cannibalism. Which, by the way, is, like I said earlier, I think, is just like the ultimate evil for this people. They considered cannibalism to be, I described it, you know, from if you talk to a Christian who would say blasphemy is the ultimate evil. Cannibalism in this culture was the ultimate evil. And the Wendigo, the spirit of the Wendigo, is the personification of that evil. It is the devil come to life for them.
And it might explain why there's such an anxiety about it. There's such a fear of becoming that and harming one's family or one's relatives or those around you. But what's interesting to me is that in these same real life stories, there are cases where their bodies change. They don't grow to the size of pine trees, but their bodies swell or their lips.
A common sign or symptom is the swelling of the body. Mm-hmm. And not in normal, not just in, like, if some people had suggested, well, maybe this was due to allergic reaction or something like that, exposure to a medicine or something that had a negative reaction. But this wasn't just normal swelling that you could just immediately say, well, that's the cause. This was abnormal swelling. But almost every case of documented Wendigo psychosis or the Witiko condition had the swelling of the body. And some other signs and symptoms of this condition would be fever and fits, psychotic breaks, and even a lot of people describing seeing the devil come after them or a creature coming after them to take over them.
It was interesting. It was actually consistent throughout a few different stories that they said the devil himself. And a lot of people would also describe the feeling or the sensation of having ice in their soul or this icy heart. Like we mentioned earlier, some people would actually try to help these people in particular by boiling tallow or animal fats and having them drink that. And sometimes if, you know, according to those same stories, if that worked, they would actually start puking up ice and vomiting ice, which...
That's scary.
It is.
Sounds painful.
Terrifying. Can you imagine puking up ice shards? Earlier, the story of the little girl, that's, I believe, why she drank the tallow, to prevent herself, having fought the monster, prevent herself from having to deal with that herself or become that same monster. There's the idea that you kind of sense from that story, knowing that everybody's afraid of becoming this. It's not so much that, you know, it is so much that the Wendigo will come and eat you, but the bigger fear is that you will become possessed by the Wendigo and you will do these terrible things.
Yeah, and we talked about earlier how in most of the cases where people would claim Wendigo possession, there was always a conversation days or weeks or even months ahead of the event where this would almost become a self-fulfilling prophecy. So it's interesting that the fear is that prominent and that pervasive that people will actually talk themselves, and the documentation of medical professionals and even priests, religious leaders, and tribal leaders showed that people would literally talk themselves into this condition because they had such a fear of it. It's almost like the fear gripped them, and very soon thereafter, there was the claim of Wendigo possession, which we describe as the Witiko condition or the Wendigo psychosis. Now, there are a couple of ways that people historically have explained this condition to come about. One of those, and always this is associated with the colder weather months, the harsh winters, lack of food. And one of the ways people are described to coming to this point or coming to this brink of this condition is through starvation.
Starvation, periods of famine. I think one of the elders that we listened to described it as overpopulation of sorts, or people who were depriving the land of its resources.
Yeah, too many humans growing in one location for too long, resources being depleted, natural resources being depleted. as a result, leading to famine conditions and leading to starvation, then you couple that with a fear, a cultural fear of this spirit or this creature taking over or coming upon a tribe or a group of people, and you have a perfect condition for people snapping and just moving into this psychosis.
That's the exact word I would use. And that's exactly what you see happen in some of the accounts, are people just kind of snap. There's one guy who, I guess, on the way to see their parents or his father or something, I can't remember.
Yeah. It was actually a man and his family, and the man actually approached the priest. There was a Catholic mission that had been established in the area. Interesting story. Going back a little bit on this story, a Catholic mission had been established. The medicine man for this area, the tribes that were represented in this area, found himself against the mission.
Right.
Violently against the mission, to the point where he had set up totems, and the Catholic priest took them down because they had been set on their property as a warning and as a curse. This medicine man, who would later become known as the Windigo prophet, actually set out people to do harm to the property and to the people of this Catholic mission.
Pretty flashy name, by the way.
Yeah, the Windigo prophet. There was a man in that community who was taken by the priests, and he, I guess, engaged in conversation with them about enrolling his children into the Catholic school and trying to discover how he could incorporate Christianity into his life and be baptized and all this kind of stuff. So this conversation taking place, and this medicine man became very angry with him and actually prophesied against him that he would be killed and he would be overtaken by the Wendigo spirit, and that the Catholic mission would suffer and would be destroyed, so on and so forth. Well, this man, his wife was pregnant during one season, and so they took a trip to go see, I think it was his father,
right,
in another location. On the way to see the father, the story goes that on the first night of camp, not much had happened. Other than that they were traveling in harsh winter conditions, everything was okay. But by the second night, this man started going mad and threatened to eat their child, threatened to eat the wife and kill them. And the wife was able to persuade him to calm down enough to get through the night.
And she actually had him stay behind, if I remember correctly, to give them kind of a head start.
Yeah, because that night he actually started going kind of nuts and describing to her that he saw the devil coming after him. He was describing to her this spirit, this evil coming through the forest after him to overtake him. And he had declared at that point that the Wendigo spirit was going to get him that night and he was going to eat his child and murder her as well. So she was able to talk him down and convinced him to let her and the child go on ahead of them to reach the town before them. However she convinced him, he agreed to do so, and he came in later on after she had already arrived in town. And I guess he started going mad there. He was going into fever and fits and threatening other people within the tribe to murder them and eat them, and eventually he was executed.
Which is sad, and it sounded like he was a gentle person up until that point, and the fact that she was able to hold him off and convince him to stay behind so that, you know, the family would have a chance, it's very sad to hear.
And here's what's really interesting about this story. We asked the question, how does one become Wendigo? How does this condition set upon a person? And one of the ways is starvation. Another of the ways we might talk about a little bit more in a minute is abuse. Extreme abuse of a person would cause that person to snap and show signs and symptoms and actions of the Wendigo condition. In this case, it's documented. It was a question that this Wendigo prophet had poisoned the man before he left on this trip, and that there was sorcery involved. And when I say sorcery, I don't mean somebody just put a curse on somebody and hope that magic took its course.
Right.
You know, sorcery, I'm talking about the use of drugs or mind-altering substances to create a desired result.
And poisons,
toxins, foods, plants that would have adverse effects on people. And the question was that in this particular case, the Wendigo prophet, who was so angry with this man for trying to incorporate Christianity into his family's life, made a self-fulfilling prophecy about the curse of the man and the Wendigo, and so he had actually poisoned the man before he left on this trip, and the poison took effect during this trip, causing him to have hallucinations and violent outbursts. And then because of that fear that was gripping that people, he just succumbed to the Wendigo psychosis.
And once again, he snapped.
He snapped. It was it. And there are many accounts of people who were, they just snapped. And a lot of it was because of starvation, a lot of it because of famine, a lot of it because of the harsh conditions that they just couldn't handle anymore, the abuse of a person. If you know, a child had been abused or a wife had been abused, stories that those abuse cases turn into this Wendigo possession.
There is a story, actually, it's very recent. We listened to an elder of a tribe.
Yeah, that was very fascinating to listen to the elder.
That was fantastic.
Yeah, I could sit and listen to him all day long.
You know, it's when we research things, we sometimes have to scour for some good reliable content, but to hear it straight from an elder is pretty awesome. Yes, one of the stories that he told was of a young girl. I can't remember, I think it was his wife that actually knew the family of this young girl. So
families, and his wife was friends with the person in question.
So it's actually a very, you know, it's within our life, within some lifetimes of us.
Yeah, I think he said this actually took place 1957, 1956-ish.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
This girl, unfortunately, had been abused by her stepfather within the community. The abuse had gotten so bad that I guess the mother had kind of gone a little haywire as well and was abusing the daughter in emotional ways. And this girl wanted to leave and to marry her boyfriend, if you will, and the mother forbid her to do so.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't like a teenage angst story, but because of everything going on, I think that was the final straw for the girl.
Right, right.
And she actually ran from the house, stripping her clothes off and going to jump in the river. There was another woman there that tried to catch her, but was unable to do so before the girl jumped into the water.
Yeah, this was a friend of the elder who was relaying the story.
And basically, the girl died. I mean, it was icy cold river. Her body was, I guess, never found, or if it was, it was, you know, she was dead. But to this day, and she's considered a Wendigo of sorts, but it's more of the wraith-like spirit that we had talked about before.
Right.
But to this day, if you go there, it's said that you feel this lonely sadness in this particular spot.
Yeah, that her spirit actually haunts that location.
And this elder had actually gone there to spend the night with a friend, and the elder did not feel anything, but his friend did feel a heavy presence and was very frightened throughout the night. But I think it's important to note this story, not because, I mean, and it's different. It's not the psychosis, if you will. It's not the cannibal spirit, but it's somebody who became a Wendigo through this heavy abuse and this mental strain until they're gone.
Right.
Mentally, they can't take it anymore.
Yeah, and it was just really fascinating listening to this elder speak and tell the stories of his people and speak of the Wendigo condition. And he would, you know, he would call it the Witiko condition.
It was interesting. He made note to say, and his wording was very interesting, because I consider these folktales and legends and, you know, stories, but he was like, he said very specifically, you know, we don't tell these stories for the horror.
Right.
And I found it interesting that he would say it that way. It wasn't for entertainment, but he said we tell these stories to teach and to remind each other that we need to treat each other kindly, not abuse each other, and so that these people do not become the Wendigo.
Right. It was a high lesson of respecting other people.
Yeah.
And it was interesting too, because he would talk about how guarded these stories were, and that for many years, decades, and these stories were not told, they were not shared, they were guarded because of the impression that other people might have about them, because they just seemed so far-fetched. But they were real cases of, and documented cases, not just within this tribe, but of people outside of the tribe.
And it's interesting, I mean, he also went on to say, along that line, it's, with full belief in it, it's very hard to explain this. There's not an easy way to, you know, explain this off.
Yeah, but when he spoke of people who had been overcome overcome by this condition. It's interesting to me that his language, it's just like if I sit here and talk to you and say, you're a guy, I'm a guy, he would speak about these people who had succumbed to the, or surrendered to the Wendigo spirit, if you will, or that condition. He would speak about them as though they were Wendigo.
Yes, as though they were like living, breathing.
As though they were living, breathing, that is what they had become, that they were no longer human. He would very specifically speak about them as though they were the Wendigo.
Yes.
And no longer human.
Very matter-of-factly as well.
Very matter-of-factly.
This is what it is.
It was very real for him. And the other interesting thing I find about some of his stories, and he talks about not being horror stories and not just being tales to be spun, but these are teaching lessons to remind people of respect. But the other thing that I found interesting about what he had to say was that this would take place every generation.
Yes, that was a kind of a wake-up call of, hey, this is a continuous process.
Yeah, he would talk about the resources being depleted and people abusing the land and abusing each other. And he actually said it's almost a way, and I can't remember if he said God or the universe or what he said, but it was almost a way that there was a generational purging,
right,
of people who were giving in to this evil. And he would describe it that he said this would take place once every generation, about every 65 to 70 years. He said it's even, he told the story of the girl being abused and around the 1950s, and he said that's really the last time in my lifetime that I've experienced something happening, although we have other stories, we haven't had anything since then.
So even though we have the pop culture icons of werewolf Wendigos or Wendigo and the White Walkers and these other things, it's still, like you said earlier, it's still very deep-seated. It's important. And I think it's something that, yeah, it's a cool story, but we still need to pay our respect and keep it in mind.
Right, and I think also keeping in mind that there is a difference between the creature, between the monster and the condition. This condition that is brought on by starvation or abuse or even in some cases been questioned sorcery or poisoning in some cases. This condition that is based on a real tangible fear among these peoples. So there are a difference between those two things, but they overlap at some point. So I think it is something that can be explored both from a folklore standpoint and from a medical, physiological, religious standpoint, and some of those overlap. But, it is very real and it's very important, and I don't think it's something that needs to be taken lightly, even in our day and age.
Right. And it's beyond that, it's an interesting topic. Just a little personal note here, there is an image going around of Wendigo having these crazy antlers on top of their head.
Right.
And we had a heck of a time trying to figure out where that came from. And
right.
I still don't think we've gotten to the root of it.
I think you found an artist, though, that...
1944.
Yeah, 1940s.
June 1944. And it wasn't Weird Tales, but it was one of those old,
right,
classic short story magazines. Yeah, but that's the one of the oldest good sources that we found that have that, the antler Wendigo icon.
Right.
So yeah, there's a lot of intricate layers to this guy.
We will put up in the show notes links to the recordings of that elder telling the stories and speaking about the Wendigo. I'll also put up links to this document that I have that is, I've read through, and it's very interesting. It's by Nathan D. Carlson, who was with the University of Alberta. He is considered to be one of the leading experts on the topic of Wendigo, and he wrote a paper called Reviving Witiko, and I have a PDF that I'm looking through that was published with Duke University, but that is an extensive and very interesting piece to read through. He goes through case by case, historically laying out the medical and even in some cases religious, the physiological aspects of the Witiko condition, goes into some stories, things like Swift Runner and talking about the implications there. So anyway, Nathan D. Carlson wrote this paper. I'm going to read just a concluding paragraph as we close this out today from that document. You know, he looks at it and tried to come from a Western perspective and give a complete, you know, analysis and explanation of this condition. And at the end of it all, he basically says there's really not a Western explanation for this that we can wrap our minds around and put our finger on. He says this about it. He says the phenomenon on the whole is here described as resulting from a cultural anxiety surrounding starvation and cannibalism, accompanied by the belief in the transformative powers of dreams, sorcery, and the Witiko monster itself, which in turn resulted in the consummation of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Such beliefs and behaviors lost cultural reinforcement with the introduction of a modern agricultural industrial economy, Canadian laws and institutions, and a conformity to Christian values and cosmology. Witiko appears to have been more of an anxiety about turning into a cannibal, a person abhorred by Algonquians as an embodiment of evil, than it was a psychosis causing one to have and act on cannibalistic impulses. In essence, Witiko reveals itself to be a social construction of the cultural world it was found within, supported by a collectivity of people who subscribed to the same cosmology. So we go back to that fear that is just so deeply rooted in that community that led to people believing that during these times of famine and harsh winter conditions that they would succumb to the spirit of Witiko and become the Wendigo.
Pretty powerful fear.
It is. It's very powerful. And so again, we have the creature, we have the monster of legend and lore, which is fascinating to look at. Some people believe he's related to Bigfoot. You have modern pop culture that's racing around with the werewolf idea and
again the werewolves,
yeah, kind of getting silly with that, and then you have the Wendigo psychosis, this Wendigo condition that is very real and very tangible and well documented. So it's an interesting topic for sure, and I believe people should jump into it, and because there are a lot of trails that you can follow when you start opening up these pages that take you in a lot of different places.
A lot of trails and a lot of layers to unpack, hope.
Yep. So it's been good talking about this, unpacking this a little bit. I'm excited to go deeper with it later on, but for now, there's an introduction, the Monster Guys podcast to the Wendigo.
There it is. I'm going to go warm up.
All right.
Maybe get something to eat.
All right. Enjoy this song, ladies and gentlemen. You have a good night.